What's up, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Team Chat Podcast. I'm one of your hosts, Jerrett Wilson, joined to my right by Rachel Mogan.
How's it going?
And to my left, Zachary Parks.
Hello.
And through the internets, we are joined by a fourth guest host this week, Andrew Mogan.
Hey.
Hey.
Yay.
Glad to have you on the show. Oft referred to in previous episodes as Bro Mogan because of his relation to our co-host.
Mogan. So you can just continue to call him Bro Mogan.
Yeah, I don't think for the duration of this episode.
Yeah, for the duration of the episode. What he's cool with it. Look at Brogan? Him. He's fine with it.
Yeah, if you guys say Mogan, I might accidentally respond.
We do it all the time when we're gaming.
I know. The few times,
Friday.
The few times I've played Overwatch with both of you, I always be like Mogan, and you're both like, yep. Like, God, no. No. That's not who I was referring
to. People used to call our house when we were kids. They'd be like, hey, is Mogan there? And we're like, which one?
It's a whole family of them.
Yeah.
I like Brogan.
So, in case you did not know, Team Chat Podcast is a video game podcast where we talk about games, the ones we love, the ones we hate, and everything in between. If you would like to get in contact with us in any way, send us a question, which, as I'm just now remembering that I should have had it pulled up, we do have an emailed in question.
Oh, nice.
From our good friend Dylan.
Oh, rare treat. It's been a while.
Yeah, it has been a while. And so podcast. He sent us an email just like you can by sending us an email by going to teamchatpodcast@gmail.com.
Should you be lucky enough read them?
Yeah, we're better than you.
He says, the subject is Skyrim.
Something I know
Zach's
about.
Zach's favorite thing.
Relevancy.
I've had a similar experience to Zach as I've been playing through the remastered Skyrim lately because I never played the DLC before either. In Whiterun, the same town that Zach met the would-be dragonborn assassins that led him to Morrowind, I walked into town one day and there was a surprise pack of vampires attacking the town. They are straight out of the Dawnguard DLC, in which an ancient vampire fighting militia is reconstituted to fight off a renewed blood-sucking menace. These vampires killed some NPCs, including one, not two, but all three of the blacksmiths that live in the village.
Oh,
not only can I sell any weapons and armor in this town, but there is a little twinge of sorrow in the town that I've never had in the many playthroughs I've had before.
Oh.
Pretty cool that a game can keep surprising you like that.
That is cool, but
what
that gave
a nasty surprise.
I was waiting for that.
But maybe it's like...
I know those blacksmiths.
Oh,
at least one.
I trade
with them. And nice. Now I know their inevitable doom.
Maybe, but what if it's like a random thing?
Maybe he just probably did it wrong. Yeah,
he probably had an opportunity to stake. Like,
that seems crazy that like the three blacksmiths would be targeted.
Yeah.
Unless
the
vampires are trying to corner the local blacksmithy trade.
What's the crime when you like witness something but you don't stop it?
Bystanding?
Yeah, bystander crime.
I don't know.
It's in the last episode of Seinfeld. That's
lazy
all. That's
crime.
How I know it. I know it via through entertainment, not the law. So
it's probably it's not even the law.
But outside of email, you can also like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, and subscribe to our YouTube channel where you can get the full Team Chat experience. Now, I did also want to take a brief moment. This is normally when I bring up the spiel about Patreon. Mm. Wanted to bring up a little change that we're instituting into the Patreon perk system. How I've said it before, I keep getting this weird feeling in my stomach every time I'd say it because I'd say, you know, for as little as $1 a month, you can support the show and we'll give you cool perks in return. Well, that was weird wording on my part and I felt bad because if you give us a dollar, you get our thanks and our appreciation, but nothing physical
it's
in return.
Perk.
It is a perk,
it's a perk,
but not in the sense of like what a normal perk
You're
is.
You're getting the podcast.
So,
period.
We're changing,
which is worth,
we're changing
which
it up
a lot.
Because we want to change up how our reward tiers and our perks work. $1 monthly, the $1 tier will get you the audio version of the episode early. $5 tier will get you the audio and the video versions early, which I know, Bro Mogan, you watch the videos primarily, so.
Yeah.
Cool stuff.
I have Patreon, so everyone else should be too.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's true. That is true.
In fact, if you subscribe to the Patreon, we might even deign to let you on the show.
It's a possibility.
That's how I got on here.
Yes.
Nepotism.
Pay to play here at Team Chat Podcast.
Pay to play. These are called microtransactions.
Oh, we're scummy.
So now, truthfully, for as little as $1 a month, if you can support the show, and in return, we will give you a cool perk, like getting each episode early before its general Tuesday release. So yeah, check this out, patreon.com/teamchatpodcast. And then, finally, one little bit of introduction to get through, the song contest.
Ooh, did anyone guess
it? No one has guessed it yet.
Yeah, no one's
I couldn't think
that.
Of... Wait.
It's, I don't know how anyone's going to guess it. It's
Should
a,
I just say it then? Or what happens?
Yeah, I guess we'll go ahead and talk about it because I'm going to put it at the beginning.
It.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So tell us about this song and where the hell you heard it from because I've never heard of it before.
This was a game on the Xbox 360 arcade.
Okay.
Which is actually, now the more I think about it, I played a lot of 360 arcade games.
Yeah, isn't that where you played that marble one? Yeah.
Wow, what a game.
Rockstar's Table Tennis.
Well, okay, that's a full fledged. I shoveled out $50 for that game, sir. It's not an arcade game. Galaxy Wars, that was a great game. But yeah, this was Boom Boom Rocket. And much like Guitar Hero, you had to time the button mashing, not mashing, but the button hits with a line, you know, so these fireworks would shoot up with A, B, X, or Y.
Okay.
And when they hit the line, they explode if you do it right. And that was one of the songs.
And what was the song called?
Oh. Electra Sonata, I think.
He made that up. I think you're right too.
It sounded very similar to that because it was a mix of a classical song.
It was. It was a good song though, right?
It was.
Regardless,
I liked it.
Being such from a strange game.
Yeah, I mean,
the two songs that Zach has picked have been the hardest ones so far.
That's
like, because
he
treasures it.
He gets so upset with our listeners that pick hard songs. No one plays Final Fantasy IX.
I played Final Fantasy IX. It's a great game.
That's how he knew it. Now he was able to guess. So this actually works out really well that he's on the show today.
That's true.
Bro Mogan will be giving us the song and hint at the end of the episode. Ooh. So stick around for
I'm
that.
I'm sure you can get this one, Zach. It's pretty easy.
Oh, okay. Well, Mogan gave me an alley-oop.
No.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
It's not going to be.
It's not going to happen.
Mogan gave me ODST.
Yeah, don't give it to him. Don't give it to him.
I'm
he
sure
got
at
one.
Least one of you three will know it like instantly.
Ooh.
Okay.
I'm excited.
We'll see.
I'm excited.
I could be wrong.
Will I really know it, bro? Will I?
I didn't say you.
Ugh.
Yeah, you guys
he
are like texting
one,
right
so
now.
So he means me.
Of course.
I'll get it.
Number one. You were number one.
Yeah.
Right. He was number one.
SpongeBob podcast.
All right. So before we get into the topic of the show, whenever we have a guest on, we'd like to let them introduce themselves a little bit, tell us a bit about themselves, how they got into gaming, brief bio, as it were. So.
Okay, yeah. Hi, my name is Andrew Mogan. As they already said, I'm Rachel's brother, and I'm a second-year physics PhD student at University of Tennessee, Knoxville. Go Vols, I guess. I'm not a big football fan, but, obligatory.
Vols. Volunteers.
Okay, sorry.
So I started gaming really when I was about six, maybe a little bit sooner than that. I just remember that when I was six, for Christmas that year, we got, from Santa, a PlayStation 1. The old,
this is
like...
a good year.
This wasn't like the original PS1, like the tiny, tiny little one. This was like the 1998 version or whatever.
Yeah.
And we got Tekken 2, Crash Bandicoot, and Spyro the Dragon, which
rock classics. Solid games.
Yeah,
I mean, Tekken 2 has aged horribly, but the other two are still great, and I still, to this day, love fighting games and platformers, and of course, I play all sorts of other games now, so I've had dozens of hobbies all throughout the years, but gaming is really the one that I've stuck with for pretty much the entire time, so since I was six, so 18 years, because I'm 24 now.
You're
That's
so young.
Wow.
Old now.
Nice. Very cool. And so then also, since you are the guest, you get to pick the topic. And so you gave us a few, and we did go with boss battles. So kind of, what direction were you looking for as far as, is it favorite ones, general opinions about boss battles?
Any and all. I wanted it to stay nice and open-ended so we could just talk about whatever. I was kind of going to talk about boss fights in the context of, a couple of different franchises and, just kind of compare and contrast a few of the major ones. There was one in particular that I wanted to definitely mention just because it's all over. If you go to Google and you're best video game boss fights ever, there's one in particular that I know is always on there.
Oh, I wonder if it's the same one that I was talking to you about before the show.
Okay, what is it? Hit us with it.
I'm curious.
Zach, you've played Metal Gear Solid 5, right?
Oh, yes. Okay.
I think you're right.
Yeah, I know where you're going with this.
So I haven't played 5, but I've played 1 through 4.
Uh-huh.
And so the boss fight of Metal Gear Solid is, of course, from the first Metal Gear Solid game, which is Psycho Mantis.
Psycho Mantis. Yeah. I said Cyberpunk Man. I forgot his name.
That's not it at all. Cyberpunk, he's psychic.
Yeah, so you having direct experience, I've only heard the tales of what it's like to fight this gentleman, but you having direct experience, it sounds like, can talk about exactly what happens when you fight this man.
Yeah, so actually the first time I fought him, it was totally lost on me because, Metal Gear Solid was a PS1 game, and I played it on my old, ancient, backwards-compatible PS3, which unfortunately crapped out recently, R.I.P.
Finally died.
When I played on the PS3, the game wasn't designed to, read PS3 hardware. And, the whole... One of the gimmicks of the boss fight is, he reads your memory card and starts, commenting on it. So he's, ooh, psychic. And he was, just not able to read PS3 stuff. So he was like, what? I can't read your mind. Ooh. He's, Russian or whatever, so he has a funny accent. But then I got the GameCube remake recently of the first two Metal Gear Solid games. It's called Metal Gear Solid The Twin Snakes. And so I got to the Psycho Mantis boss fight, and okay, this is a whole thing that I can ramble on and on about. So basically, like, what happens is, in Metal Gear Solid 1, you are, you know, Solid Snake. You have to infiltrate this base and foil a terrorist plot, right? And so your commanding officer's all like, there are all these scary terrorists. There are Sniper Wolf and Vulcan Raven and blah, blah, blah. Oh, and by the way, Psycho Mantis, he's psychic. And then he's like, oh, and also save my niece while you're there. And you're like, okay, cool. So you go in there and, like, you eventually find his niece. Her name's Meryl, and she winds up coming back for later games. But anyway, so in the first game, you meet up with her, and you kind of start, like, backtracking through the base. And then you get to this big office. It's like the commander's office or something. It's like this big room with a bunch of fancy bookshelves and, like, a mahogany desk and a couple of, like, stone busts in the corners. And then Meryl starts acting kind of weird, and she, out of nowhere, like, starts talking this really weird voice. And she's like, do you love me, Snake? And you're like, excuse me? Like, just out of nowhere. And then she starts going, like, real, like, just throwing herself at Snake, and she's like, make love to me on the table. And you're like, no, this is weird. And so eventually what happens is, you know, you're facing toward Meryl, and you see this, like, shadowy figure kind of pop up behind her. Turns out it's Psycho Mantis. So he is a pretty slender guy. I want to say he's tall, but maybe he just looks tall because he's always floating off the ground because, you know, he's psychic. And he's, like, ghost pale. He wears, like, this leather... It almost kind of looks like a wetsuit, but it's not really a wetsuit. It's just like this leather garb with, like, all these straps and chains and these long black sleeves. And, of course, to make him look even more horrifying, a gas mask.
So yeah, he's pretty creepy looking.
He reminds me of Valdo from Soul Calibur.
Yeah, kind of. He's got, like, the same kind of, like, slender, pale deal with the mask on. So kind of like Valdo from
Soul
Calibur.
Also a real creeper.
He speaks English, unlike Valdo. And so, yeah, it turns out he's, like, mind-controlling Meryl. And what he does is he starts, like, he's like, here, have a demonstration of my psychic power. And so first, he reads your memory card to see how many times you've died and how many times you've gotten caught, like, up to that point in the game. And if you're like me, it's 1,012,000,000 in both stats. So he just starts shit-talking you. Like, every time I go up against him, he's like, ooh, I see you're a poor warrior, ha ha ha. And I'm like, come on, man. And then he starts reading, like, what games you like. So, you know, I was on the GameCube, so, like, in the original PS1, he might say, like, oh, you like Castlevania, but on mine, he was like, I see you like The Legend of Zelda and Super Smash Brothers. I was like, how did you know? And then the really funny thing is, like, what'll happen is he'll be like, okay, now I'll show you my telekinetic powers. Lay your controller flat on the ground. And so you lay it down, he's like, yes, just like that. And you're like, oh, man, he does know. So you lay it down, and he's like, ha-ha! And he, like, does all these crazy gestures on the screen, and then your controller just starts vibrating, and you're like, oh my god, he's moving it with his mind. It's just so funny, because it's like, you know, this was a game that was originally made in, like, 1998, and it just really showed off how, like, wacky and crazy Hideo Kojima is with all of his game design choices. And then, like, so he does all that, and he's like, okay, demonstration over, now we fight. And the first thing that happens in the fight is, like, okay, 1998, you're on an old, like, crappy CRT television, right? And so the first thing that happens, screen goes black, and in the top corner you see these green letters that say Hideo, which that's spelled H-I-D-E-O. So, like, if you're not expecting it, you're just like, oh, I'm back on the video channel. Because, you know, back on old TVs, to get to your game channel, it wasn't HDMI, it was just called, like, video or AV or something.
Right.
So you're kind of like, oh, my thing crap. Wait a second, that says Hideo, not video. Oh, God. It's just, like, part of the fight. And finally it starts up. And you start, like, trying to shoot him, and he's, like, mind-controlling Meryl this whole time, and he's, like, trying to make her shoot you, and so you're trying to knock her out without killing her, and then you're trying to shoot him, but then you can't hit him. And he's just like, ha ha ha, I read your mind. And then, I don't know exactly, like, how it's supposed to trigger, but I know that usually for me it's after the first time I die. Then you'll, like, respawn, restart the fight, and then Colonel Campbell, your commanding officer, comes on your codec radio thing. He's like, Snake, I've got it. Try, and then, like, shameless fourth wall break. Try plugging your controller into port 2, and you're like, what? And so, turns out, that's the whole thing, is, like, he's reading your mind by reading your controller inputs. So, on the PS1, you plug in port 2. On the GameCube, you have to plug it all the way into port 4. And then you can just hit him, because he can't read your mind anymore. And, like, every time you hit him, he's just like, why can't I read you? Oh, no. And then, so you can beat him that way. Supposedly, I actually tried this last time and I couldn't get it to work, but supposedly, you know, I mentioned there were, like, stone busts in the room, and I think they're supposed to be of Psycho Mantis, but they have, like, these straps on and a mask, that kind of looks like his.
Mm-hmm.
Supposedly, if you can shoot the straps off and get the mask to fall and like reveal the face, then he like sees his face. And he's like, oh no. And then he like gets distracted and you can kill him or something. I couldn't get it to work. I tried shooting those things for like a solid 5 minutes and I was probably just doing it wrong.
It's a very Oscar Wilde type of deal.
But then that's
deal.
Not even like the end of it though. It just gets even cooler because like when you finally kill him, you know, the Metal Gear Solid games are all like crazy dialogue heavy. Like every cutscene is like 20 minutes long.
Right.
The ending cutscene to Metal Gear Solid 4 is an hour and 20 minutes long or something.
God, is that
it's
true?
Crazy.
Crap.
What? I didn't know
that.
Jesus. Which one is that? Guns of Patriots? Which one is 4?
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah, of course, Guns
is that
of Patriots,
old
the
Snake?
Last cutscene because it's like 40 minutes of, you know, closing things, then the credits, and then huge plot twist. That's like another 20-minute cutscene.
Oh.
Like it goes on forever.
Wow.
But anyway, so you kill Mantis, and as he's dying, he goes into like this long soliloquy about how like the first time he ever read someone's mind was his father, and like he was like, I could see that my father hated me because like his mom died during childbirth and his father never forgave him, and he was like, I thought my dad was gonna kill me, so I burned my whole village down. And you're like,
oh,
ugh.
As a child.
Like, so he's going into like this really, you actually like start to feel kind of bad for him because like he takes his mask off as he's dying, and you can see his face is all like scarred, screwed up, and he just looks really pathetic. So it's actually like, you know, it's so fun, and you're like, this is so crazy, and then you kill him, and you're like, aw. So it's just crazy emotional roller coaster. It's
sounds
the
effective.
Fight itself.
It sounds effective.
The whole scene. Yeah, it's very like, this game pack a punch like emotionally. Just, I mean, they're a little over the top, but it's still like, especially for 1998, it was a big thing.
Yeah, to be able to, and that's what I think, I guess, why it would top all the boss battle lists.
Yeah,
wouldn't
you hear stuff like that?
For, especially for that PlayStation 1 game, like that amount of...
It's very creative.
Yeah,
in-depth, the words escaped me, but the amount of creativity, that went into like having it interact with the controller, which is definitely not a thing. Like, did they even have the original... Did the original PS1 have Rumble?
It did.
It did?
Probably.
Did it?
I don't know if it did.
Oh, did they not?
It might not have.
Because the original PS1 controllers didn't even have the analog sticks. It was just
buttons. Okay, I'm thinking
of
ours.
That was like
JK.
The very original. That was like the 96 or 94.
Yeah, never mind. I'm thinking of the later version.
So that's pretty crazy that they were that inventive about being able to read the memory card and then be able to put that, you know, all that stuff in and then also interact with the controller. It's just a really like random way to go about having a boss fight.
Sure.
I love that they would have taken that much time to record all those different voice options.
I was just about to say that.
That's crazy.
Yeah. A lot of you had to really look into that one, because what if somebody's playing like some random ass game,
and that they then apparently redid it for the GameCube version, right?
Yeah, so they're different games. So like, you know, he'll say like Zelda, or like for me it was Zelda and Smash Bros, because I don't really have a whole lot of data on my GameCube now because I got a new one recently. He didn't mention Kirby Air Ride, which was a little upsetting.
Oh,
I was like, come on,
that's
a
greatest game ever.
If he mentioned it.
Maybe it just like picks the top three or something like that of the three most recently played, but I don't know. But that's still pretty cool.
Well, with age and considering how long ago this was, I'm sure it comes off as a little bit gimmicky now than when it originally
it did.
However, I am still very much a fan of this idea. And I think it could, and like, I know we were talking about it, sort of laughing about it, but everything that you said, I was like, that's awesome.
No,
that's
it sounds awesome.
Yeah,
yeah.
Well, that's one of it's not necessarily with a boss fight per se, but that's one of the reasons why I loved Until Dawn so much.
Yeah,
is because it had so much interactivity with the controller. Was, you know, it had moments where it was like, don't move, and you had to hold the controller
still. Right.
And which was normally very hard to do because, you know, your hands still have a slight little shake to them. Got the shakes.
If you're like me, you've only had the one cup of coffee.
That's right.
Don't play this game early in the morning.
No. Yeah.
But you're tense because you don't want a character to die, and it's very stressful. But it's all about like holding it, and it seems to go on forever. So again, it's not necessarily a boss thing, but still a great implementation.
That kind of like hardware interactivity is a really interesting concept.
It is.
And there should be more of that.
There should be, because I really don't think I've ever played a game that really broke the fourth wall in such a way that Psycho Mantis does. I mean,
unplugging a controller and having to plug it into a different port.
Yeah,
I mean,
that's
obviously
crazy.
Like now,
I tell you
it's
what
all
would
wireless.
Have gotten me
so.
Is when it switches to the video component, it says Hideo, and you don't notice first of all. And I'd be like, oh my, did it just turn off? Like I am so gullible and such a sucker for that stuff. I would have been like, oh, like let me just unplug the system, and then like, oh wait a minute.
You know, like I yes, I would have been. I would have.
My saves.
I know. I would have remembered the
it's
last
only
second.
Up like 5 seconds.
So yeah, I mean, I think it's great. Not enough to throw me off. Definitely, I would have been very thrown off for sure. Because again, just real quick, that comes. This is before really you go online to look at certain secrets or certain gameplay walkthroughs, anything like that. So this, I think, even more effective the fact that it's you alone with the game and you really don't have any sort of outside information about what's happening or what could happen, anything like that.
Right.
Which is a beauty that has been lost in video games. I'm kind of bummed that so many games... That's another conversation.
No, let's bond it. Let's bring in boss battles. That sounds fun.
But, you have to like intentionally black yourself out with games that you don't want to know about.
You do.
Like, you have to make a point of like, anytime somebody brings it up, you're like, no, don't tell me, and like just never Google
it's
it.
That's true. But it's a whole
thing. I mean, this is probably dangerous putting this out there, but like the game for me that's like that is Mass Effect 3, because I know like the ending of it is so crazy or so divisive among gamers or fans of Mass Effect. Like I don't want to know what it is, but every time I hear Mass Effect being brought up, which now it's being brought up more and more
because
of Mass Effect
of
Andromeda. No. Every time I hear it on a podcast or anything, mute please. I don't want that. I don't want that spoiled. Of course, it's going to take me forever until I get to Mass Effect 3.
The first one, right?
So I mean, if I haven't started the series, I mean, I would love it in a perfect world to go spoiler free. But I know the possibility of that is very unlikely.
With that attitude, come on, you gotta you gotta be strong.
Pick yourself
steal
up.
Yourself. Go for the gold.
Back to sauces.
Back to
I made that joke way too many times.
Meta joke.
Didn't work.
Damn it. Because you told it three times before we started recording, and now we're recording.
My joke was, bosses? I thought we were doing favorite sauces. Which, it's still funny, right?
Marinara.
I don't think Andrew had heard it. See, he laughed.
There we go.
It's ranch, buffalo, honey mustard.
Barbecue's always in my top five.
Oh, bosses.
So this is something that Zach and I were kind of talking about earlier before we started recording, is that how we don't necessarily feel like we were talking about this. And one boss that always stands out to me as a big one is the boss that you fight at the end of Dark Forces, the Star Wars Dark Forces, the first person shooter game from. Do you know this one?
Nope, never heard of it.
All right, check it out sometime. You can buy it on a PS1 classic on PlayStation.
Old. Another PS1 era game.
But it's it is. I think it was 98, 96, somewhere in there. But anyway, you fight at the very end. You fight the General Mock, who is in charge of the Dark Trooper project. I won't go into all the backstory of what that is.
Thank God.
Because
thank you, sir.
You people don't know Star Wars, which
we won't appreciate
it. But you have to fight him at the very end. And this was probably the first game that I can think of playing that I actually had bosses that like I play. Well, that I played through to completion enough to where I actually got to hit the final boss at that time in my life. But he was a really great one. I just remember because it did a really good job of you run into these other Dark Trooper prototype soldiers in the game, and where like one has a sword, one has just a bigger weapon, but then he was in like the phase 3 outfit of the Dark Trooper suit, and it had like a rocket launcher, a shotgun style gun. It was just, you had faced a lot of different enemies all at once before, but you never faced one who had everything, basically.
Yeah.
Was the whole thing about him. So I remember it took me a long time to be able to beat him. But so that one obviously first came to my mind when we were thinking about boss battles. But after that, I was like, what else? Like, because there's obviously the obvious ones, Bowser, all the multitudes of Mario.
Dr. Robot, or what is his name?
Robotnik from Sonic, There's always those ones that come up with, which everyone knows what those are. So, spoiler alert, we're probably not going to be like, oh, my favorite one's Bowser. But
that was going to be my favorite, God.
I mean, it could be, but I mean, you know, it's just still. But then I was thinking about it, I was like, I don't really know of many others, because like I don't play the type of game that has them.
I was gonna say that is because you are missing out on an entire genre, JRPG,
which is why we were talking about this, I was like, oh, the Mogans will be able to go
crazy.
Yeah,
so long, I was like, oh man, how many per game? What is this, disc 1, 2, 3, 4,
right.
5?
Right. Right. And so like what Zach and I were talking about is like how we like games more where the boss fights are seem more incorporated into the story, then like you're entering.
So poo-poo on your theatrical boss.
where it is more of this, like you enter the stage, the music changes, and you know you fight him and all that kind of stuff. I don't know.
That sounds so boring.
And I know, but that's like, but the, in my head, when you say a boss fight, that's immediately what I go into. So then we were thinking about it more of different,
and we were laughing about Halo, for example, and I was like, oh, like. Halo doesn't have bosses. Halo's a story driven, and it's just, you know, it's weaved perfectly. But then,
JRPGs,
unlike JRPGs that are confusing.
No, because your brain is so small from all the Halo. They are confusing.
I don't know how to say any of their names.
Halo brainwashing.
But then we realized that Halo does have bosses, in fact, and they're just sort of
Just missed them all these years.
You just sort of don't.
You just
realize,
come across them,
but
they do
have, like, for Halo 3, for example, the first time you fight a Scarab,
yeah,
that's like a boss fight. Everything kind of goes dark. You defeat a bunch of enemies, and then this big, you know, rumbling sound.
Mechanical, walking
and
tank,
it comes
basically
over the bridge, and you have this whole scene where you have to fight it. And same with Halo 2 at the end. You fight a brute. I mean, in Halo 4, at the end of Halo 4, you there's a boss. So
there are bosses.
There are bosses, but
we
play
them.
It doesn't. When I think about bosses in, like, a traditional sense, you know, a lot of my picks came, or a lot of my things that I was thinking about was from Star Fox, for example. Star Fox, I thought, had a really great, 12 great bosses that you get up to, all the way up to Andross.
And that's the amount minimum a game should have.
Oh, yeah.
It should have that many bosses, at least 12.
A baker's
12.
Dozen?
And 13. If you don't have that many, you're not doing something right. There should be a whole army of them.
Well, I will say bosses in that sort of more traditional end of level, this now you can progress to next level, is something that triggers something nostalgic, and it is a very pure essence of a video game. You know, it's like, oh,
like the
it's
video
a
game boss is iconic.
It's a guy,
like,
yeah,
that's
that
where
idea.
That word comes
right.
from.
Right, it's never been like, in any other sort of realm
from
of
like when Mario had to run up the ladders to stomp on Donkey Kong.
Yeah. It's like a boss.
The original boss.
The original boss.
I'm not sure if that's true. Don't
that
quote
might
me
not
on
be.
That. It's probably not true.
Probably not.
So,
bro,
like,
you're a
when
genius.
You're talking about bosses being like an end of level thing, how do you feel about like boss run games where it's like all just boss, like Shadow of the Colossus, Fury, and stuff like that?
See, that's what I was thinking, because I made the joke to Zach earlier, too. Well, I was just like, oh, I mean, we could talk about Dark Souls, but literally every enemy in that game is a boss.
It's a boss, yeah.
Because, you know, you can't take any of them for granted. Any enemy in that game could end your life and your run.
Not even
in
one.
A second.
Well, let me ask, in Shadow of the Colossus, for example, a game I've never played, is every enemy you come across boss-esque?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
They are
bosses.
Does one outshine the other to be a bigger boss than the other?
Oh,
like,
well, see, the whole point...
Final one,
that's a bad example.
Yeah, okay.
Because the entire point of Shadow of the Colossus is that all of the bosses are the biggest and the baddest thing you've faced so far.
Okay.
So they do scale up, and the final
but
one, like Bro
they,
says...
Even
the
first one
massive.
Feels like a boss.
Yeah, oh, yeah. Actually, okay. I think the very first boss that you fight in Shadow of the Colossus has a ton of just emotional impact because... It's the first of many, but it's so awe and fear inspiring when you first start to go up against this huge giant stone beast, and you're just like, oh my god, I'm gonna die. You're a puny little dude.
Because in this game, you climb the legs, right? Like you're this, and they're
huge. They're so huge, you have to like physically climb them to even fight them at all, and that happens throughout the entire game. So that's a very interesting example, but it's kind of its own standalone thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay.
So obviously we just got to get into JRPGs.
Give me a good example.
JRPGs.
If you were trying to sell me on a good boss.
Outside of Legend of Dragoon.
My favorite brother will surely be able to back me up on this one. So probably not even bosses in general, but one of the subclasses of bosses that is one of my favorite things about JRPGs, and some Western RPGs will kind of do it too, is the optional super boss.
Oh my god.
That's
such a JRPG thing.
It's such a JRPG thing. So the optional super boss is this recurring thing. Really, you could probably find them in the vast majority of JRPGs. Any turn-based battle system where you have a big open world and a crazy backstory and 3+ discs, you're gonna have an optional super boss. So the whole point of the optional super boss is... it's a thing that you could miss every time. You could play the game 1,000 times and never technically fight the boss if you didn't want to. They also almost always have 80 billion, million health. You're going to be there all freaking night trying to fight these things, and they can insta-kill you with every single hit. Like, they can always insta-kill you. It's a struggle just to hang on to life.
Right.
And you have to use everything you've got and so much of your precious brain power that you're running so low on by the end of the battle. And so some of the best ones that I can think of would be Faust from The Legend of Dragoon.
I was just about to say that.
Excellent super boss. Because, like, when
you first find him, you can't even damage him.
No, you can't.
You can actually find him in, like, disc 3 out of 4. And if you just go straight to him, he's like, leave this place. And you're like, you know everyone's dead around here, right? Because he's, like, guarding some ancient ruins that have been abandoned for, like, a bajillion years. And you're like, nothing's here. He's like, what nonsense? I am blah, blah, blah. He was, like, the old, like, wingly...
He was the high priest, wasn't he?
Yeah, he was, like, a general of this ancient race. And so...
He's basically a ghost, but still alive.
Turns out, you have to run around the game and collect all 50 Stardust, which are insanely hard to find. And so, then that gives you a Vanishing Stone, which then makes what turns out to be the apparition of Faust disappear. And then you go down this whole other, like, warp puzzle level, and then you get to fight the real guy. And then he kills you anyway.
And then he kills so
it's
actually,
all in vain.
He brings up a very good point. Usually the super boss, it's not just that you can miss them. It's that they're really freaking hard to get to in the first place.
Right.
It's a fight just to get to the super boss. Mm-hmm. Another good example would be Golden Sun, that really old Game Boy game.
Yeah.
Bro, did you play Golden Sun?
I played a little bit when I was pretty little, and it was lost on me at the time, so I need to replay it someday.
You missed out. So Golden
you
Sun...
You done missed out.
Silence.
So Golden Sun had an optional super boss, which in terms of difficulty, very low, like, on the list of most difficult super bosses ever. But it was such a good setup to the super boss, because in the first place, you get on the ship to the middle of nowhere to, like, a fictional island. And then you actually wind up finding the island, which is Crossbone Isle. Ooh. Oh, it's like a pirate hideout. And you're like, oh my gosh. You like pirates too. Don't even pretend.
Pirate Robot Island. All right, go ahead.
So the entire sequence is you're fighting your way down the subsequent levels of a dungeon. And all of the monsters are really, really hard. They all have high HP. They all do so much damage. There's like 5 of them in every battle, which sheer numbers is really difficult to deal with when it's a turn-based battle system. Mm-hmm. And then every level, you're just collecting more and more awesome treasure. So it's like, oh my God, I'm so glad I came to this stupid island. And then you get to the very bottom of this dungeon, almost like a funnel shape kind of in your head, and there's an underground lake. And you're just like, oh, this can't be good. We were already in the ocean. Now we're in this underground lake, and I don't like this at all. And then there's another ship, and you're like, oh, no, I don't like this either. But of course, you and your crew, you have to board the ship, and you get on, and like, there's nobody on it. You're like, okay. So you're just kind of walking around, and unlike every other boss in the game, this super boss has no overworld sprite. So, like, you know, in the really old Game Boy games, they were all pixelated. And obviously in the overworld, when you weren't in battle, there would be sprites of everything. There's no sprite. The game just kind of cuts to black. There's this screeching noise, and then you're in the battle, and you're like, no, I wasn't ready. Like, you don't even really do anything to trigger it other than walk into the region, and you can't tell just by looking at it. Mm. And then it's this giant, skeletal, armor-clad ghost pirate who's like, nice try, sucker, you're not getting all of my gold, but he doesn't talk. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, he tries to murder you.
Of course.
So it's not difficult, but it's a very fun and engaging example of a super boss, because he is pretty hard. You can pretty much take him out in a couple of tries if you really stack your deck in your favor. But once you beat him, you get like a piece of armor. It's not that great. But here's the thing that I really love about it. This game already had a sequel to it planned out. So they knew they were going to be making a Golden Sun 2. And in the Game Boy, you could transfer data from one game to the next.
That's nice.
Through like a code at the end of the game.
Okay.
So if you've beaten Deadbeard, his name was Deadbeard. Now that I think about it, it really was. So the optional pirate ghost super boss's name is Deadbeard. If you beat Deadbeard and then finish the rest of the game and get Golden Sun 2 and port your data over, eventually you just get this neat little cutscene at the very, it's not even at the end, it's just randomly at one point, some rando pirates come through and they're looking for the crew that you had in the first game. because they're like, oh man, we've heard about this guy. His name is Isaac. Him and his crew, they beat the pirate king.
That's
and now
cool.
We're pretty sure that he's our boss. So like, have you seen him? And you're like, I think he went that way. And they're like, sweet, that's our new boss. So like, they're chasing
that's
after the
neat.
People you were in the
yeah.
last game. And you're just like, oh, I'm famous.
Yeah,
I did all that
cool.
work for something.
That's
pretty
really cool.
So you don't really like get anything out of it other than fame and glory to last the
ages. I was
going to
say, like the cutscene is just a cutscene. It doesn't lead to any other gameplay.
No, it doesn't lead to anything. You just get this cool little cutscene and the knowledge that you're old guys now have pirates at their command.
Mm-hmm.
For
that's
all
immersion.
Eternity.
That
and
helps
like,
with the
yes.
immersion level.
So that's a prime example of excellent super boss cross game functionality.
I like nice. That. That's really interesting. Something you were talking about how hard that or Andrew was talking about going down to just find that one boss is something that I think is one of the more positive sort of aspects of bosses is in that modern games, I think, are shying away from, and they're becoming a much more cinematic experience and less of you fighting against the game, more of you kind of going with the game. Is and that's something I've sort of missed as of recent is the real sense of achievement in games. And I think
exactly.
that's something you don't get as much. And I'll say even games like Halo that I love, it's like you're supposed to win from the get-go.
Exactly.
And with bosses... Yeah. Like, and I just think about Metal Gear Solid 5, there's Psilanthropist is this huge robot that you have to fight many times and it gets stronger and stronger. Or there's like the fireman who's in like every Metal Gear game. Isn't he like the guy that's on Man on Fire? Is that right? I thought he was. Oh, you would know. I wouldn't. I've only played 5. I was told
that. Is that the cousin of Cyberpunk
well, 5
Soldier?
Is a prequel, right? So chronologically, 5 comes before 1. Like it's way back in like the 70s, whereas 1 is supposed to take place in like the 2000s or so.
Man, I wish we could show Andrew an image, but it's basically this man that's on fire. And
I mean,
but
you could look it up and
yeah, but with look, but with
him, oh look, there's
I see a black screen.
That's you.
I see
Andrew.
My reflection.
Basically, I mean, this is kind of off the point, but he also has like a guy that's in a also in a gas mask and he can float. And I wonder if that's supposed to be some sort of rendition of
okay. There's something like that in Metal Gear Solid 3, but I don't think it's like a recurring thing.
Okay, well, regardless, this is a boss that you fight several times in Metal Gear, and the amount of achievement that you really, the sense of achievement that you get. Yeah, can you see that guy? Kinda.
Nope, that is
brand new.
Unless I just have a even worse memory than I suspect. I've never
okay,
seen that.
That's,
he looks
that's the
cool,
man on fire.
Yeah,
really cool, and he's one of the bosses that you fight, and it's really you know.
I'd be scared of that guy.
And basically, just as a quick brief, the first time you fight him, or maybe it's not the first time you see him, but the first time you have a real interaction with him on the ground is you're sniping him, you're shooting him, and nothing's working. And that idea of this puzzle, like how do I kill this thing? And then you start to realize that there's a water tower over there. There's a Jeep over there, and you have to like take the Jeep and ram it into the water tower when he's in the right place. I mean, it's crazy hard to figure out.
Yeah.
And so that sort of excitement, it's hard to find in games without real puzzles that a good boss can be.
Right.
It really, and I totally agree that in more modern games, unless you're still in the JRPG like genre, like I do with Bravely Default, you don't find many, if any, formal bosses like we would know them from the past. And I agree that I actually hate that. I hate the lack of bosses in a lot of modern games. I'm like, where are they? I need to feel the sense of accomplishment. Like, I like that it feels flowing, and I like the streaming process on the one hand. And on the other hand, it feels like, I don't know, it just feels like you're not overcoming as many obstacles as you should be. It's like, yeah, I fought all those waves of little guys, but
so a game, so a modern game that had bosses, like an actual like old style, like short like intro to the boss and then you fight the boss that I did not expect at all to have it, Titanfall 2.
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't even know it had a campaign.
It does. Well, that was the big thing. Titanfall 1 didn't.
Oh.
Titanfall
2
did.
That's pretty awesome.
That was like the biggest drawback. Yeah. You'll go through the level, and not every level has one, but you'll go through and there's like a mercenary force that was hired by the big bads, and there's an iconic character. They're like five? Yeah, I think five. And they will confront you. A different one will confront you at the end. Like the first one is Kane, and then I think is Ash. Anyway, four, about five of them. But and you have to fight them at Titan to Titan.
Oh.
do they stuff. Are like they like tricky? Are they like, do they all have, you know, when I think of a boss, they have like a move that's like,
yeah, well, they're all in different Titans.
Okay, so they
so
all have
different. They're the different classes of Titans. The first one, Kane, I'm pretty sure is just the normal Ion class Titan, yeah. Standard one, everybody starts with that. And then Ash is in a Ronin, which is a sword. It has a shot, like a shotgun weapon, and then it, when it gets up close, it has a sword.
It's really skinny. I've seen him play that really one. I'm like, look at that really skinny little robot.
It's so cool, though. The Ronin is my favorite anybody. By far. And then, yeah. Oh, but so this is the fun thing. So the interesting thing, the last boss in that game, the last one that you fight, I did not think was the hardest one.
Now,
that's a big problem in modern games.
That's something that I wanted to kind of bring up, because you know what other franchise is really, really guilty of that? In at least more than one instance that I can think of?
Mm-hmm. What?
The Legend of Zelda.
The earlier bosses being tougher than the final?
I have played many, many games where earlier just ran... Any boss, any mm-hmm. of them. It could be a dungeon, it could be a mini-boss. I have had many times throughout multiple games of the series where the final boss... Piece of cake.
Yeah.
Nothing. Yeah, actually, I just beat Twilight Princess, the HD remaster, I think like last night or the night before.
Oh, cool.
And yeah, the Ganon fight is not, it's nothing. It's cool, like it's pretty fun, but it's not hard at all.
It's not hard.
And that's, oh, sorry.
Go after, may I take your head, sir?
Oh, sorry, thank you.
Speak over you.
Sorry, like a weenie. I apologize.
No, excuse me, sir.
Excuse me. But no, so, the last boss in Titanfall 2, other Titans would come to her aid and all this, and so you know there was situations where it'd be three Titans on one, or then even some smaller troops would come in too, but those are more annoyances than actually doing anything to hurt your Titan. But the one before it, Viper, was that boss. Oh, we need the camera real quick. That one was by far the hardest one, although because he Viper is an airborne Titan, so he's flying around, whereas all other Titans that you've really fought have been ground-based. There are a couple supers, which, like, the Titan will launch in the air and, like, unleash a barrage of missiles. But that's pretty much the only air, so to have one suddenly be in the air, I was just like, oh my god, what is happening? And that one took me forever.
And you finally beat it, though.
Yeah,
and it feels good.
I beat the game, and it felt great, yeah. But then at the same time, it was just, like, the final boss, which I thought there was going to be one more boss, but then it turned out there wasn't. And when I got to that one, and maybe that's why I didn't feel like it was hard, because I was expecting another confrontation.
Yeah, that could be.
So, but yeah, so that, without getting too much into spoilers of the game, since it's relatively new. But yeah, so that one, definitely, I was just like, oh, that kind of.
Now, I'm not sure if this would apply to Titanfall, but at least in a few instances of a couple of different games, a lot of Nintendo ones, like Metroid Prime did this too, and The Legend of Zelda almost always does it, there's kind of the setup to the boss fight wherein you often have the type of battle where you're meant to use everything in your arsenal that you've gotten through that point.
Yeah.
So it'll like shift through different stages, or you'll be in different worlds, then you have to use this weapon,
right.
And then the boss will change strategies, and you have to use this one instead. Mm-hmm. And that's
Metroid Prime does it a lot.
Yeah, Metroid Prime did it in all of them. Yeah,
I remember Twilight Princess doing it as well.
Oh yeah, Twilight Princess did it. They even kind of did it with the Zant battle too.
Mm-hmm.
So it's
the Zant battle makes you cycle through like every because he always like changes the background.
Yeah.
So he'll be like, ooh, spooky magic, and then you're back in the forest temple, and you have to use your boomerang to knock him down. Mm-hmm. And then like, ooh, spooky magic, and now you're back in the fire temple, and you have to use your iron boots to like magnetize to the floor.
Yeah.
So he goes through like everything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I like that as a function, because in like through storytelling,
it's a great mechanic in storytelling.
Everything that you've done like up life. Until then, collecting all of this crap was for a purpose,
and the purpose
is to beat that guy.
Yeah. And it's simple on the surface, but it is very effective in making you feel like you're learning, using it into
So actually, one of my biggest complaints about boss battles then would be the final incarnation of Ganondorf, Demise, that you fight at the very end of Skyward Sword. Spoiler, Jarrett, cover your ears.
No!
That you fight at the end of Skyward Sword. The only thing you use against him, which is kind of artistic and also kind of boring, is your sword.
Hmm.
You only use your sword and shield.
That's cool.
But it gets very repetitive.
Oh.
But it's as a basic.
So I understand why they did it from a storytelling perspective. Yeah. I totally get it. But the fight itself, very underwhelming, repetitive. Kind of boring.
It's a bummer.
Yeah. The fight before him, where you basically beat his minion, Gierheim, was much more interesting.
Yeah.
So it's just this dynamic of the final boss can occasionally be a letdown compared to others you fought up until then.
And speaking of boring bosses, I think a lot of modern shooters are really guilty of this as well. And you hear the term bullet sponge a lot.
Yeah, and that's how The Division was.
The Division's like that? I think Destiny's
like that. I've heard Destiny's like that.
Yeah, Destiny came like that too, yeah. It's like that, and it's a bummer.
Did Destiny coin the term bullet sponge?
I don't know where
I heard
sponge
the term really coming up a lot more after Destiny and Division.
I mean, it's you almost can't even call them bosses. They look like bosses, and they act like bosses.
Like, they'll kill you fast.
They'll kill you fast. They're big. Like, I'm thinking of that in Destiny, for example. One of the first bosses is this chained goblin that's big, and it's got chains.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
And it has, like, three bars of health or whatever, and you take one down, two down, three down. And it has no real... I mean, it has some sort of
and there'll be, like,
interesting
swarms of other
sure,
enemies
they
to come along.
Way.
But
exactly. But there's no real
it doesn't
strategy.
It doesn't have, like, a... It doesn't have a
button on the back. It doesn't have any sort of weak spots. It just...
Oh, you're just shooting... Oh, that's so boring.
That's like that ogre one, it had like its head was
maybe
obviously...
It
would do more damage if you shot it in the head. But for the
really
most part,
shoot, reload, shoot, reload.
And kill some other guys so you can pick up more ammo.
Exactly.
Shoot.
And that's,
you
know, I always come back to Destiny as a big complaint. A game that is infused with a first-person shooter and magical elements, you'd think they would have a lot of interesting ways to incorporate a boss and for you to use your whole arsenal of powers, but it at the end of the day you're just shooting things a lot. And the Division's like that too. And the Division doesn't have the Division does have bosses.
Yeah, it does.
It does. It has like the fireman, for example.
Yeah.
I remember him. He was this like guy that has like two flamethrowers.
The cleansers,
yes.
Yeah.
And
Joe Fry or something like that was his name. Because it's all just like these normal people who suddenly like, this city's gone to shit.
Right.
Now
and
I'm
they
a
just
warlord.
Turn on, they just turn on this thing that they I guess have had the whole time to be a crazy person.
I was a banker before, but thank God for this.
Right. Yeah, Wall Street crashed and they like know how to use two flamethrowers. But him, for example, I remember fighting, which was fun. Like, I did have fun.
Yeah,
but
I died a lot fighting.
You died a lot, but you just shoot, and you don't
Shoot his air tanks, and that explode and hurts him. So it's like he has minor weaknesses, but for the most part, you're just throwing ammunition
you're
into
just,
him.
Yeah, like an unbelievable amount.
Yeah.
I mean, the amount of ammunition.
That's how I
and
felt
really
like...
boring at the end of the
and
day.
Yeah, and that's how I felt about the end boss of the Division. Did you ever get that far?
I don't know.
So...
Wait, I don't know.
The main general who leads the LMB, Last Man Brigade or something.
The MBA?
No.
The WMBA?
No, not that. But anyway, his boss
Donald
fight, you see this guy, you hear him, you know what he looks like, but then his boss fight, he's up in a helicopter that you have to fight.
Okay, I don't know.
And then it's legitimately just you shoot guys on the ground who are coming, then you look up and just unload into this helicopter and repeat until he's finally done.
Yeah.
Lame.
And so, it was pretty boring.
First-person shooters have a tough time of having bosses.
I think Titanfall did a really good job with it. Like, it was cool that they even had that. Like, the
I
campaign
bet
that of
the
Titanfall
Titan
2...
The mechanic, though, helps with that
it does.
A lot.
It does.
Yeah.
And Titanfall 2 was... I mean, I'll say it again. It's great. You guys go play it. And so that one, to me, just really stuck out. What you were talking about of how you use all your resources and all your things, The Last of Us actually has a level like that.
Bro loves The Last of Us.
Yeah, I'm trying to think of like which one you could be talking about.
The bus depot tunnel.
It's been a while, so.
The bus depot tunnel right before you get to the hospital. Where you have to go underground. It's right when after you see the giraffes.
What?
I'm trying to think of what boss is in there. Like
it's,
I remember
it's
the
not
area,
a boss.
Yeah,
it's not a boss necessarily.
Was drunk.
It's just there are a ton of like the big bloater infected ones. And
okay.
And then it's just, and then clickers, normal infected. It's just this whole room, basically. That's just
like that room is kind of a boss in itself.
That's what I mean.
Really tough.
That's what I mean is that room is you go in there and it wipes out everything you have. You craft and use every scrap of salvage that you have. You use every bullet. You use every arrow. It is so hard. I've been wanting to go back and replay that one and play it on a harder difficulty than what I did. And I've been seeing people like apparently going through that on grounded, the like hardest mode or grounded plus is just insane.
Grounded is like borderline unfair. Like this is kind of off topic for a boss episode, but I played that on the remastered version and like it just kind of felt inconsistent. Like I would do the exact same thing twice in a row. And one time I'd get through just fine. The other time I'd get caught and it was kind of like, what?
That's weird. Yeah, I need to go play through on that one because I want to try out those harder difficulties. But that one area I remember especially. You get through it and you're like, I really hope there's nothing like this is the end of the level because I'm fucked if it's not. If there's so more.
Fucked.
And there are absolutely those moments in boss battles, like especially in JRPGs, where they cut to like a cutscene kind of, mm-hmm. and you think the battle is over, and you're like, else. Oh, thank God, I was out of potions, revives,
right.
wins, right. all of it, and then they're like, just like, kidding, how? Sucker, yeah. bitch, you thought, and then it's the next boss, and you're like, no, well, and you have nothing, and you die, and then you have to start all over through the unskippable cutscene at the beginning.
Oh my God, it's like that super crazy. That is my one beef with boss fights, as you have to rewatch the same damn cutscene.
Back in the olden days, they were not skippable,
right? And not, now they are.
Now
like,
they
you
are.
Go through and like and skip through. But I'm just like, but that is the bane of my existence when I do have a hard boss. I'm like, why? Man. Oh my God,
Ursula in Kingdom Hearts 1.
Yeah, Kingdom Hearts was a really bad like perpetrator of that. They like I remember one terrible. I had to watch a bajillion and 12 times in the first Kingdom Hearts game. Was it was one of the Riku boss fights because he winds up like being evil for a while.
Yeah,
and I think it's like. It's in the last level of the game. It's like in Hollow Bastion or whatever. And my God, I had to hear the same rant about hearts and friendship. Blah, blah, blah. It was horrible. And I just like mash start, like maybe it'll skip this time. And it never did.
But that was like the best thing about the Kingdom Hearts like 1.5
HD remix. They added skip cutscene.
Nice.
Best thing in the game.
Best thing in the game.
Totally worth the repurchase.
Worth the repurchase.
That's funny.
Do we have enough time?
Yeah,
there's one more just facet of certain types of boss battles, especially in JRPGs, maybe a little bit in Titanfall, I'm not quite sure, that is a fantastic thing. I think in particular that Final Fantasy really excels at is, in Final Fantasy, you may or may not know, one of the primary game battle mechanics is one of your characters will be able to summon. Like these deities, borderline deities, or like these gods or something, and they are like your mega arsenal. And one of the best things about, in particular, Final Fantasy X had some fantastic aeons. So those were your summons. And
yeah, because like in Final Fantasy X, they changed it up a bit. Because in previous games, your summon was just like a one-move thing. Like you would summon like Bahamut or whatever, and it would just blow stuff up and then leave.
Yeah.
But in X, you can summon, and it's like a whole separate character.
Yeah,
so like you summon Bahamut in X, and then he has his own like menu of like attack, explode, item, whatever, and like he just does his own thing, and so it gives you a lot more staying power in boss fights, especially.
And what's really interesting about that is, for many of them, the way that you would get these aeons, you would have to fight them. What's the one in particular? What is Seymour's? Oh, what is his?
Ooh, that's the best one.
Yeah,
Anima.
Yeah. What is
like
that one called?
Crazy because so
Anima.
Seymour's like yeah.
Oh, Anima was a fantastic aeon battle. That was a crazy wild.
Yeah, because
one.
Like you fight Seymour because it turns out he's the bad guy. This is like a quarter of the way
what
through
the
game, so it's not super spoilery.
The huge creeper was
and then he's
the
all
bad
like,
guy.
Check out this cool aeon I have, and it's just this giant like. It's hard to even describe. It's like this brown. Giant, like, monstrous creature with its arms chained up in front of itself.
Imagine
it is all, like, moving around all crazy.
Like it has, like, really sharp teeth, and it's chained up.
Creepy.
And
that's terrifying.
Yeah, that
at certain
terrifying.
Points, you actually go beneath kind of the ground, and there's more of it. It's actually a second half with another head.
Underground?
Yeah, kind of.
Yeah,
it's hard to describe.
Things
it's hard
are nightmares right there.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
What
Anima is like
it?
A living nightmare.
Anima?
Look at it. Oh, yeah. We should look at it.
Yeah, we got these phones. We got these little computers in our hands.
The
we can
internet,
look at stuff.
God. And so Anima is a really good example of, a battle in and of itself. Anima is a boss. You have to fight it, and it is freaking hard.
Mm-hmm.
And B, once you finish the battle, you get Anima in your team.
Well,
you can.
Not in that case, actually. Like, there are a bunch of Aeons that are like that, but actually...
I thought you could get Anima.
You can, but not that way. You have to actually get Anima, you have to do with this whole side quest.
Oh, that's right.
So in the game, there's all these cloisters of trials, which is like this big puzzle room before you get each Aeon.
Oh, that's just the top half.
Yeah, so like in the games, you have to like do every puzzle like 100%, and then you get Anima.
That's
you have to do this whole extra side quest.
That.
It's kind of difficult. But.
I guess I was confusing it because Anima is like kind of mixed into Seymour's whole backstory.
Yeah, he is a boss fight, and you can get him, but it's not in that order.
But I love that entire mechanic, like that you would fight something that is so difficult, and then eventually it joins you, and you're just like, yes.
Yeah,
yeah.
Pretty cool.
Finally.
Sure. I mean, like, real quick, that's like in, you know, it's really not, I feel like a lesser, not a lesser game, but like a sort of lesser idea, but it's in Skyrim too, like the dragons.
Oh, yeah, that counts.
That's adorable.
That counts. Your little flying lizard friends.
They're an enemy, and then you capture one, which is actually what I'm doing right now. Ooh. That's actually a really great scene, you capturing this dragon in this castle. It has this huge opening in the back. And you like chain it up and everything, and then you get to like ride it around.
Nice.
Yeah,
that's badass.
That's pretty sweet, though.
Al Duveen. Sorry, that's the Fustura. Wait, no, that's the Thum that you say in order to summon him out of the sky. That's his name, Al Duveen.
Oh, so
you
that's
go,
lame.
Al Duveen. And he's like,
nerd.
Damn it.
He's like, I gotta go carry this dude.
Yeah, I love it. Oh, I'm such a nerd when it comes to my Thum. Feel the power of my Thum. I want to tell strangers.
Oh man,
that's Fustura. Punch you in the
face.
I know.
That's why it's so funny. You dumb kid.
So, do you want to go ahead and do a moment with Mogan?
Or did yeah, I guess I had one.
You have one?
Okay. We can kind of close it out after this, I
moment
think.
Yeah.
All right, so quick update. Building off of... Yeah, I'm going to smack you one. Building off of last moment with Mogan, you remember I mentioned that Xbox One, December, posted their best sales much ever.
Yep.
Newsflash, PS4 totally beat Xbox One for the month of December 2016.
Point for PS4.
Point for PS4.
Was that for a whole year?
No, that wasn't for the whole year, but for the month of December.
I thought you said it was beating everybody.
It was. Oh. So Xbox One was on a streak, and then PS4 came
back. Oh, I see. Oh, so it's about even again.
Yes,
okay,
I'm not sure
what
the actual...
No, PS4's still on top.
Yeah, but it's still top.
It's still better. We got Google that one.
Still better.
Actually, a lot of the games on the list of most sold, like just sheer sales, were from Xbox.
Yeah, makes sense.
Like, they may have been also for PS4, but it didn't list out which one for which. And then just some other random news. In case you missed it, pre-orders for the Switch itself, the Nintendo Switch, Breath of the Wild Special Edition, and Breath of the Wild Master Edition are all sold out already.
Wow.
So
you're having to hunt for that Switch then, aren't you?
Didn't pre-order it?
I thought you would have been like
I thought you would have been on it.
On top of it.
I had it. They canceled it.
What?
It was one of those things where they oversold it.
See, I was worried.
They had to go back and
when you said today
it.
That you finally got Breath of the Wild from Toys R Us.
I double checked.
Well, because Sam and I bought...
Your NES
Classic from Toys R Us, and the same thing happened.
Well, what actually happened with that
was got one from Amazon,
all
so
of the
all
other big the other big retailers, Best Buy, Walmart, Target, and GameStop, they actually launched their Breath of the Wild pre-sales earlier.
Oh.
Toys R Us didn't. Toys R Us opened theirs just this morning.
And oh, wow.
I was checking religiously because I knew they hadn't done
it yet.
Finger
on that refresh
button. I was like,
button.
I know they haven't done it yet.
Yeah.
It's coming soon. Because like they had it on their website. They were like, Breath of the Wild, coming soon. And I was like, I'm on to you guys. I'm on to you. And then they opened this morning and like shaking hands at the keyboard, typing in my information. And I got it.
Nice.
And then about 2 hours later, they were like sold out. And I was like, score.
So what did you actually get?
I got the special edition. So
she doesn't have the console.
You don't
have the
Switch.
Okay.
I still don't have the Switch.
You got the special edition.
It was twice.
All right.
So now it's like, well, shit. But really, that was the thing that I wanted more than the actual console itself.
You'll get the console.
I'll get the console.
Get the console when you get it.
I want the collector's edition.
Surely they'll restock before launch.
I feel like they probably will.
Nintendo. Restock before launch.
Well, they said Nintendo North America came out with a statement. They were like, oh, don't worry. We've got 2 million units planned for the initial launch, which is a lot.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's going to be fine, but fingers crossed.
Yes.
Fingers crossed.
And then just a couple. Oh, they are already more Nintendo news. There are already rumors per Eiji Aonuma, one of the Nintendo big bads, that there will be another Legend of Zelda for the Switch. Maybe down the line. They're not sure. But
see how well Breath of the Wild does.
Yeah. Well, I feel like
Didn't the Wii have two?
No.
Twilight Princess Skyward Sword?
No, Twilight Princess was a bridge.
Oh, okay.
So Skyward Sword was its own thing. But then again, Breath of the Wild is technically a bridge.
Yeah,
so, good point.
Go.
But also the last game for the Wii U.
I know.
Womp, womp, womp.
Poor Wii U.
R.I.P. Wii U.
Rest in peace.
Thoughts and prayers are with you.
Yeah, and then in case anybody for Xbox needed news, it was hard to find. Gosh, there's so little out there.
Point for PS4.
Come on, you're making stuff up.
I gather that this is a game people like. make Path of Exile, which is apparently a Diablo-style action RPG, which was previously just for PC, is now coming to Xbox One. So I guess people are jazzed about that, and it's still apparently going to be free-to-play. So it's kind of like a Diablo-esque free-to-play game. They do have microtransactions, but I was doing more research on it, and apparently it's kind of a shining example of, like, microtransactions done really well.
Yeah,
Because it's only, like, the optional add-ons of, like, vanity items, more or less. So it's like, well, you can pay for these, but it's just, like, to look cool. And it's like, good, that's the stuff I will pay for.
Right.
I do that in real life. And then the other important stuff, out today on January 4th in the future, Resident Evil 7.
Fourth? Yes.
24th, is that what I said?
I thought you just said the 4th.
No, yeah. Sorry. 24th.
Okay.
January 24th, Resident Evil 7 for PS4, Xbox One, and PC. I will probably get that. Yakuza 0 for PS4. Missed that one last time, my bad. Tales of Berseria is now out for PS4 and PC. And then coming soon, we have Disgaea 2 for PC, January 30th. Memoranda, an interesting-looking indie game based on the short stories of Haruki Murakami.
Hmm.
Books are for chumps, but this is a game based off a book, so it's going to be fun. It's going to be pass. So that's going to be for PC, Mac, and Linux, and you can get it through Steam January 25th. And then Conan Exiles for PC coming January 31st.
There you have it.
There you have it.
Moment with Mogan, everybody.
Andrew, you have to applaud.
I am. Look,
he's doing it. There's just a delay. Slight delay.
He wasn't doing it loud enough.
Yes.
There we go. Now I can hear it.
So if it's all right, like before we close out, can I ramble on about one more boss?
Go for it.
Oh, yeah.
Let's hear it.
Yeah. And also, while I'm thinking about it, I actually noticed this earlier, but I just kept forgetting to say it. I think my mic, you know, it being a cheap little $15 one, I think, like, whenever I start talking, it, like, makes it to where I can't hear anything you guys are saying. So I think I've been interrupting you all this entire time. So sorry about
that.
No, you haven't been.
No, you're good.
Oh, okay, good.
Model guest.
But either way, whenever I talk, I still can't hear you guys at all. So,
FYI.
Anyway, so I was going to mention, like, one of the best types of bosses, I think, are the ones that, like, just totally reinforce what the game is about, like, at its core. And the example I'm thinking of in particular is actually from Dark Souls 2, which is, like, the black sheep of the Dark Souls family, because it wasn't directed by, I think his name is Hidetaki Miyazaki. It was the one game that he didn't direct, so a lot of people just hate it. But the DLC for that game is phenomenal, like 20 out of 10, super good. And so there were three chapters of DLC. There was the Crown of the Sunken King, Crown of the Iron King, and Crown of the Ivory King. And the whole goal is to collect these crowns, and you bring them to this place, and it lifts the curse on you. Whee! And so in the Ivory King, there's, you know, it's not the hardest Dark Souls boss, but I think it's, like, the best designed, in my opinion. Because what happens is, so you go to this place called Frozen Aleum Lois. It's just like a big winter wonderland, frozen snowy castle. And I'm already a total sucker for snowy castles, so I immediately love this magical place.
Zach loves the snow levels, too.
I do love snow levels in Halo and Twilight Princess when you go up to the cabin.
Oh, Snow Peak. So I was listening to that soundtrack today.
It's great.
Oh,
and it's wonderful. And it's just one of the darker sort of turns in the game, which
literally,
is
literally, because it's snowing, you can't see the sky. Hmm. It's fantastic.
So anyway, you walk up to this frozen castle, and, like, the doors burst open, and this, like, icy wind comes out, and you hear this disembodied voice that's all like, turn back, this place has been corrupted by the abyss, blah, 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 and you're like, so you just go charging on in, as you do in Dark Souls. And it's really cool, because they give you two main branches right at the start. If you go left, there are two boss fights, and you're done with the DLC. Two boss fights, and you have the crown. Bim, bam, shabam, you can leave. But they're impossibly hard if you don't first go to the right. So to the right is, like, the entire rest of the DLC, and that, like, branches out into all this other crazy stuff. So if you go left, just right off the bat, you'll see a fog wall, and you're like, ooh, boss time. The first boss is the king's pet. So this is, you know, a castle. It's its whole own kingdom. And the whole point is this kingdom was corrupted by the abyss, and you're trying to fix it or whatever. And so you fight the king's pet. But it's invisible. You can't see it.
Hmm.
Yeah, there's, like, all this blizzard stuff going around, and it's invisible, so you can only see its footprints, and, like, sometimes it has this move where it'll, like, summon all these ice crystals and try and shoot them at you, so you can see that. But otherwise, what you have to do is you have to go, again, to the right path at the very beginning and, like, go through all this crap, and then you find this item called, like, the eye of something, or the something eye, something about an eye, and then you can see the pet, and you can kill it. Then you get to the second boss, which you walk in this big room, and you meet the disembodied voice. Turns out it's the queen of the kingdom. Her name is Alsana. And she's all like, maybe you can save our kingdom. And you're like, duh. And so
that's why I'm here.
Then you can go down these stairs. And what you see is this big, like, circular pit that just goes straight down. And around this pit, there are four chairs. Three of them are empty. One of them has a knight sitting there. And in front of the pit, there's a little fog wall. So you can tell, like, okay, this is going to be another boss. So if you go up to the fog wall, the one knight, like, stands up and, like, gets to the edge of the pit. And you're like, is he about to follow me in? Turns out he does. So what happens is you go through this fog wall, you plunge down this giant pit, and you go from snowy winter wonderland to this big lava pit. Oh. And you're just on this little circular platform with, like, these two bridges coming off of it. But the bridges both kind of cut off into nothing, so they don't really do much. And so on the four corners of this circle now, there are, I guess there's three of them. There are these three portals. And out of these portals come these big black knights that just start trying to kill you and your one little buddy. And so the whole, like, lore thing, if you actually read into it, is like these knights followed the king into the abyss and they all got corrupted. So they're evil black knights, and there's like a bajillion and four of them. And what happens is, if you go in there with only, I've actually never gone in there with just the one knight, because that is the dumbest thing ever. The knights are supposed to plug up these portals. So, again, I'm kind of just guessing here, but I think if you only go in with one knight, he'll only plug up one portal. The two other portals keep going, and then, you know, there's the whole, you know, boss fight that hasn't started yet. This is all just like a prequel to the boss. And what happens is on, like, one of those bridges off the circular platform, this giant, like, fiery door of death pops up and opens up, and you see this giant health bar appear at the bottom of the screen. It's just like, the burned Ivory King. And so he's just like this corrupted, just gross looking. I actually don't remember what he looks like that much, but, you know, he's the king of that kingdom, and he's just all like, bleh, and he's just like trying to kill you with his sword and whatever. And so, again, I've never fought just him in the one night. So, turns out the whole thing I was trying to get at with, like, how this reinforces the game is it's like, you know, they'll let you do the dumb thing, but if you do the smart thing, you're way better off. And, you know, the whole thing about Dark Souls is, like, you have to look for the lore and the story of the game. Like, you have to look in that game to really understand it.
Right.
And so in Frozen Lamlois, you have to look around and explore the entire thing. And remember how I said there were four chairs around that pit and there's only one knight? The three other knights are all imprisoned in the kingdom. And so you have to run around this whole place. And this is, the DLC in Dark Souls 2 is insane hard. Like, even if you save it for the very end, it's still the hardest part of the game. And so you just have to fight your way through all this crazy, confusing place, find all three knights, then come back to the pit, and you have all four knights that are like, all right, let's do this. And you're like, yeah, it's so cool to just, like, walk through this fog pit, and these four knights just jump down with you, like, let's go. Just fight off these waves and waves and waves of black knights, and it's even with the four knights, it's still really hard. Like, that's the part I died to the most, honestly. Like I said, the Ivory King himself isn't that hard. He's, like, kind of medium-ish tough. But the Black Knights are super hard because, like, some of them will chuck fire at you and some will be just hitting you. And so three of your four knights will plug up those portals. You don't have to deal with them anymore. And then you and your one lone remaining knight are like, all right, let's beat up the Ivory King. That was my favorite part of, like, the entire Dark Souls 2 DLC, which overall is, like, the best and most difficult part of Dark Souls 2. I think when people, like, diss on Dark Souls 2, they should play the DLC before, like, talking shit, because that's the best part.
Bam!
Talk shit, get it?
Nice, nice.
That sounds like an awesome battle.
It does.
I clearly did not get to that one ever.
Incorporates a lot of what the game is known for.
I'm still barely into first Dark Souls.
Yeah, so if you buy Scholar of the First Sin, which I think it's like the updated version of Dark Souls 2, so I think that's also on, it's definitely on PS4. I would assume it's on Xbox One.
Yeah.
So that comes with all the DLC. So you just, like, find an item in the game that will let you warp to each of the three DLCs. And so, highly recommended. Super fun.
Nice. Zach, you've got an Xbox.
I guess that means you can play Dark Souls.
Yeah. Point for Xbox.
Point for Xbox, sure.
It's available.
It's available.
Very nice. Well, yeah, so I guess that pretty much wraps it up. So it's kind of funny, now that we're actually talking about bosses, I actually am now remembering.
Yeah, I know. More came to memory.
More
me too.
Came up. I was like, oh.
Save it for part two.
I learned a lot from Super Mario Galaxy.
Oh yeah. That one has a lot of fun ones too. Yeah.
Like, you know, easy ones, but nonetheless.
Yeah. But still, they're bosses. That come. Yeah, I was like, oh, Diablo 3. Borderlands.
Duh,
yeah,
Diablo is full of them.
I know, right?
Is it because I brought up Path of Exile? A Diablo-esque action RPG coming to Xbox One.
I thought of it before that, but I was like, man, why the hell didn't I talk about Diablo? But yeah, I'll save it for bosses part.
This
part
is going to be a part two.
Bosses part
volume two.
But we, of course, would like to know your favorite bosses or favorite type of boss battle that you've come into contact with throughout your gaming exploits. So send us an email at teamchatpodcast@gmail.com or send us a message on Facebook, Twitter, or comment below the YouTube video on YouTube. But before we go, we do have to do the song.
Exciting.
Bro, did you think of something?
Yeah,
I've got a spot early on.
So as the winner of the episode, past episode, I'm not going to try to keep that straight.
4011.
Yeah, episode 49 or 50, I don't know. One of the last episodes. Andrew, you get to tell us the song and your hint. Or don't tell us the song, just give us the
hint. Yeah, I wasn't going to spoil the whole thing. Okay, so the hint is, in the city of death, you can find an old friend.
In the city of death.
So once more, in the city of death, you can find an old friend.
And he thinks one of us has played this game.
Or he will know what it is.
Or we'll know
I think so.
Okay.
In the city of
death. I mean, I'll find out because he's got to send me the link.
So. I already have an idea, but he said I might not know it. So I don't know.
It sounds familiar to me.
I'm going
to see if I can
death.
Try to think of it
before.
This
one feels like I could get.
Yeah.
Feels like it.
Feels like it.
But it's probably not.
It doesn't.
I hope it's not so generic that it applies to like 12 different games. Because
I don't think so. I don't know. I don't know what it is.
I got to hear it. Okay. I need to hear it, to be honest.
We'll find out.
Yeah. I'm missing this. Yeah, that's right. We get to hear it.
Yeah, we'll have to hear it and all that stuff. But I guess that concludes this episode of Team Chat Podcast. Until next time, I'm one of your hosts, Jarrett Wilson, joined to my right by Rachel Mogan.
Adios.
To my left is Zachary Parks.
Bye-bye.
And over the internet's Andrew Mogan. It was a pleasure having you on, finally.
Thanks for having me, guys.
You're welcome. And stick around for the song. We'll see you all next time.